Hi everyone, Adrienne here. Today I will be reciting and breaking down The Raven by Edgar Allan Poe. The reason why I'm doing this is because a couple of people have recently messaged me and asked me, okay, what does this part of The Raven mean? What does the poem as a whole, like, really mean? And so I thought that this video would be a really good idea for better comprehending The Raven. Now, I want you guys to understand that this video is not intended to insult your intelligence. It's meant to kind of educate and help you better comprehend this. So, if you think I'm insulting your intelligence, please know right now that that's not the case. So, with my trusty Edgar Allan Poe book handy, I'm going to recite it to you, and in between verses, I'm going to explain what that verse means. So, here we go. Once upon a midnight dreary, while I pondered, weak and weary, over a many quaint and curious volume of forgotten lore, while I nodded, nearly napping, suddenly there came a tapping, as of someone gently rapping, rapping at my chamber door. "'Tis some visitor," I muttered, "tapping at my chamber door, only this and nothing more." Okay, so this line, he's reading, he's on the verge of falling asleep, he's tired, and he hears a knocking on the door, and he's just kind of dismissing it, saying, "Oh, it's just a visitor knocking at my chamber door. I shouldn't be freaking out right now. Not a big deal." Ah, distinctly I remember it was in the bleak December, and each separate dying ember wrought its ghost upon the floor. Eagerly I wished the morrow. Vainly I had sought to borrow from my books surcease of sorrow, sorrow for the lost Lenore, for the rare and radiant maiden whom the angels name Lenore, nameless here forevermore. So, in this verse, it kind of goes into better detail what he's feeling. He's thinking heavily about his late wife. He misses her, he loves her. He can't really seem to get over his memory of her. And so what he's doing is he's reading to sort of occupy his thoughts with something else. But like he said, in vain I had sought to borrow from my books surcease of sorrow. So I tried to occupy my mind with something else, but I really just can't. I'm still feeling bad because my wife is dead. I'm sad. My whole world is still pretty much crushed right now. And the silken, sad, uncertain rustling of each purple curtain filled me with fantastic terrors never felt before. So that now, to still the beating of my heart, I stood repeating, "'Tis some visitor entreating entrance at my chamber door. 'Tis some latent visitor entreating entrance at my chamber door. This it is, and nothing more." So here he's kind of trying to reassure himself that he shouldn't be terrified of anything. He's just saying, okay, it's just someone coming to visit me in the middle of the night. It's not a big deal. I shouldn't be so irrationally afraid of this, blah, blah, blah. I just need to get over it. So, yeah. Presently my soul grew stronger, hesitating then no longer. "Sir," said I, "or madam, truly your forgiveness I implore. The fact is, I was napping, and so gently you came rapping, and so faintly you came tapping, tapping at my chamber door, that I scarce was sure I heard you. Here I opened wide the door. Darkness there, and nothing more." So here he's kind of mustered up the courage to say something to whoever is at his door. He's saying, "I'm sorry, I was napping, I didn't hear you. I'm sorry, I didn't get up right away." And then he opens the door, and there's no one there. Deep into that darkness peering, long I stood there wondering, fearing, doubting, dreaming dreams no mortal ever dared to dream before. But the silence was unbroken, and the darkness gave no token, and the only word there spoken was the whispered word, "Lenore?" This I whispered, and an echo murmured back the word, "Lenore." Merely this, and nothing more. So immediately, since he's thinking of his late wife, he's assuming that her ghost is trying to visit him somehow. So he says, kind of, Lenore, is that you? And there's no one there. There's seriously, legitimately no one there. So the only word that he hears is his wife's name because he whispered it. So, yeah. Back into the chamber turning, all my soul within me burning, soon again I heard a tapping, somewhat louder than before. Surely, said I, surely that is something at my window lattice. Let me see then what there it is, and this mystery explore. Let my heart be still a moment, and this mystery explore. 'Tis the wind and nothing more. So he hears the tapping at his window, and he's thinking, okay, there's something at my window right now. I thought it was something at my door, but apparently not. So, he says, okay, I need to chill out and see what's at my window. I don't know what's going on here. Open here, I flung the shutter with many and flirt and flutter. In there stepped a stately raven of the saintly days of yore. Not the least obeisance made he, not a minute stopped nor stayed he, but with mien of lord and lady perched above my chamber door, perched upon a bust of Pallas just above my chamber door, perched and sat and nothing more. Okay, so he opens the window and in comes this raven who is completely majestic, very mysterious to him, and he's kind of entranced by its presence. And the raven flies in and sits upon a bust of the goddess Athena above his chamber door. So he just perched and sat and doesn't really make any fuss or anything like that. He's just sitting there. So Pallas here in the Raven is a reference to the goddess Athena, who is the daughter of Zeus, and she's the goddess of infinite wisdom. So just keep that in mind. Then this ebony bird beguiling my sad fancy into smiling, by the grave and stern decorum of the countenance it wore. Though thy crest be shorn and shaven, thou, I said, art sure no craven, ghastly grim and ancient raven wandering from the nightly shore. Tell me what thy lordly name is on the night's Plutonian shore. Quoth the raven, nevermore. So here he's kind of a little bit astonished at this bird's presence, and he's kind of wondering where it came from. And he says that this raven must have some kind of higher intelligence other than just being a normal animal flying around. There must be a reason that he's here. So he asks the raven its name, and the raven repeats, nevermore. And when you see the nice Plutonian shore, I want you to think of the Greek god Hades. And Hades, when the Romans came around, became Pluto, and Pluto is the god of death. He's the god of the underworld. He's the overseer of the underworld. So when Poe says the night's Plutonian shore, he's referring to kind of the entrance to the underworld, if you think about it. So the raven kind of has a dark association, which I think is actually pretty cool. And the raven repeats, nevermore. So Poe's kind of wondering, what's going on here, man? Am I on drugs? What's going on? Much I marveled this ungainly fowl to hear discourse so plainly, though its answer little meaning, little relevancy bore. For we cannot help agreeing that no living human being ever yet was blessed with seeing bird above his chamber door, bird or beast upon the sculptured bust above his chamber door, with such a name as nevermore. So here he's thinking, wow, this bird can talk. And the word nevermore by itself kind of has no meaning to me, but what does the bird mean by saying that? And he's thinking, this is a really rare occurrence. Like, since when do ravens come in and perch above your chamber door and start talking to you. So he's wondering what's up. But the raven, sitting lonely on the placid bust, spoke only that one word, as if his soul in that one word he did outpour. Nothing farther than he uttered, not a feather than he fluttered, till scarcely more than muttered, "Other friends have flown before. On the morrow he will leave me, as my hopes have flown before." Then the bird said, "Nevermore." So he's saying that must be the only word that he can say, as if that's the only word that has meaning for him. So then he says, "Other friends have flown before. On the morrow he will leave me, as my hopes have flown before." So he's saying that, pretty much all my friends have deserted me. This bird is going to leave me tomorrow, and I will be all alone. And basically, my life has no meaning right now. So then the raven replies, "Nevermore," meaning that he's not going to leave. The raven is not going to leave. Startled at the stillness broken by reply so aptly spoken, "Doubtless," said I, "what it utters is its only stock in store, caught from some unhappy master whom unmerciful disaster followed fast and followed faster till his songs one burden bore, till the dirges of his hope that melancholy burden bore of never, nevermore." So here he's saying that whoever owned this raven must have been a pretty depressed dude, and he taught his raven to say that, and the raven kind of picked it up on his own. So that's what he's thinking. "But the raven still beguiling my sad fancy into smiling, straight I wheeled a cushioned seat in front of bird and bust and door. Then upon the velvet sinking, I betook myself to linking fancy unto fancy, thinking what this ominous bird of yore, what this grim, ungainly, ghastly, gaunt, and ominous bird of yore meant in croaking, nevermore." So, here the narrator is saying, this bird's kind of intriguing my curiosity, and it's kind of cool that he's talking to me here. But I'm really confused why he's talking to me, why he's saying nevermore to me. What did he mean by saying nevermore in response to my questions? This I sat engaged in guessing, but no syllable expressing to the fowl whose fiery eyes now burned in my bosom's core. This and more I sat divining, with my head at ease reclining on the cushion's velvet lining that the lamplight gloated o'er. But whose velvet lining with the lamplight gloating o'er, she shall press, ah, nevermore. So here he's kind of thinking, why is he saying nevermore? I don't get it. But he's noticing the intensity of the raven's gaze on him. And he's kind of reclining, kind of trying to chill out, figure it out. And then he's reflecting on his wife. And he says, "But whose velvet violet lining with the lamplight gloating o'er, she shall press nevermore," meaning that she's never going to sit on these chairs ever again. Because she's dead. She's gone. I'm never gonna see her again. Then methought the air grew denser, perfumed from an unseen censer, swung by a seraphim whose footfalls tinkled on the tufted floor. "Wretch," I cried, "thy God hath lent thee, by these angels he had l sent thee, respite, respite and nepenthe from thy memories of Lenore. Quaff, oh, quaff this kind nepenthe, and forget this lost Lenore." Quoth the raven, "Nevermore." So he's noticing that the atmosphere is getting a little more intense. He's thinking that the raven note has some kind of hidden knowledge about Lenore. And he's saying, okay, well, if the raven here was sent by the god of death, and he must have some knowledge of Lenore, but I want the raven to forget about it and quit tormenting me with this. By the way, the references to nepenthe, here in the Raven, Nepenthe was a drug that was used back in the mid 1800s, maybe a little before that. And it was used as kind of an antidepressant medication. So people who, well, not really medication, I guess it was kind of a drug. It kind of gave you a high to make you feel happy. So he's saying, I don't want to take these drugs anymore to make myself feel happy. So please stop talking about her. So then he says, so then the Raven says, nevermore, meaning that she's gonna forever dwell in your thoughts. And you're never going to forget about her, and therefore you're going to be sad. So there we go. Prophet, said I, thing of evil, prophet still of bird or devil, whether the tempter sent, or whether tempest tossed thee here ashore, desolate yet all undaunted, on this desert island enchanted, on this home by horror haunted, tell me truly, I implore, is there balm in Gilead? Tell me, I implore. Quoth the raven, nevermore. So here, when he says, whether tempter sent, so here is a reference to the devil. And he calls this bird a prophet, thing of evil, prophet still of bird or devil. So even if you're not evil, you're still a prophet. But somehow I think you have more power than you're letting on. He's saying, is there balm in Gilead? Meaning that in some other world, does it really exist? Or is it just something made up by man? So then the raven says, nevermore, meaning there isn't. Prophet, said I, thing of evil, prophet still, if bird or devil, by that heaven that bends above us, by that God we both adore, tell this soul with sorrow laden, if within the distant Aden he shall clasp a saint and maiden, whom the angels name Lenore, clasp a rare and radiant maiden, whom the angels name Lenore. Quoth the raven, nevermore. So here he's saying, okay, if what you're telling me is true, then you must have some hidden knowledge about Lenore. You must know if I'm going to ever see her again. And the raven's answer to that is no, you're never going to see her again. Even in the afterlife, you're never going to see her again. So, yeah, that kind of sucks, huh? How would you like to be told that? Seriously, man. Be that word our sign of parting, bird or fiend, I shrieked, upstarting. Get thee back into the tempest and the nice Plutonian shore. Leave no black bloom. Wow, seriously? What is wrong with me today, man? Be that word our sign of parting, bird or fiend, I shrieked, upstarting. Get thee back into the tempest and the nice Plutonian shore. Leave no black bloom. Wow. This is irritating. Be that word our sign of parting, bird or fiend, I shrieked, upstarting. Get thee back into the tempest and the night's Plutonian shore. Leave no black plume as a token of that lie that soul hath spoken. Leave my loneliness unbroken. Quit the bust above my door. Take thy beak from out my heart and take thy form from off my door. Quoth the raven, nevermore. Okay, so this is probably one of the most important lines, well, not lines, but verses in the entire poem. This is, I don't believe you. You're basically full of shit. And you need to get the hell out of here. And he says, leave no black plume as a token, meaning don't leave a feather behind so I will have a reminder of you. I want to forget this because this is bullcrap. I don't believe you. So he says, take thy beak from out my heart and take thy form from off my door. So when he says, take thy beak from out my heart and take thy form from off my door, he's meaning quit hurting me with your lies and get the hell out of here. And the raven says, nevermore, meaning, no, I'm not gonna leave. I'm definitely not gonna leave. And the raven, never flitting, still is sitting on the pallid bust of Pallas just above my chamber door. and his eyes of all the seeming of a demon's that is dreaming, and the lamplight o'er him streaming throws his shadow on the floor. My soul, from out that shadow that lies floating on the floor, shall be lifted nevermore. So what he's saying is that the raven still hasn't left yet, and he's still sitting on the bust of Athena above his chamber door, and he basically has no intention of leaving, so he's going to kind of dominate Poe's life and watch over him, kind of marking him for death. And that's not cool. At least for Poe, it isn't. He's really going through a hard time with this and thinking, this thing's going to dominate me my whole life, and I'm going to be sad for the rest of my life, so what's the point? And he says, my soul from out that shadow that lies floating on the floor shall be lifted nevermore. So he's saying that my soul is basically being shadowed by this raven, and nothing's ever going to make me happy again. So, yeah. There's The Raven by Edgar Allan Poe. Now, one thing I would like to get you thinking about is that when Poe was writing this, his wife was dying of tuberculosis in the next room in his house. So he was pacing back and forth, and he was writing this, and he was kind of putting his heart and soul into this. And there's a reason for that. He did it, one, because he loved his wife, two, because he wanted to provide for her because of her illness, and three, this poem was kind of a psychological release for him. It made him kind of go through a rehearsal of what life would be like without his wife. That's pretty intense, man. Seriously. So, it was a labor of love, literally, and he kind of expressed his feelings that he knew that he would feel after his wife died through this poem. So, anyway, I hope you guys enjoyed that video. I hope you got something out of it. And I'm hoping that you will subscribe and comment and like and whatever, if you haven't already. And if you have any more works by Edgar Allan Poe that you would like me to read and or interpret, please leave your comments below. If you have any thoughts to add to what I put out there through my interpretation, then feel free to leave them. So I love you guys, and I will see you guys later. Bye!